I'd like to welcome all of you here today. People have come from all over the country and, in fact, as far away as Australia to be here. Today's symposium, as you know, is dedicated to the work of Phil Fricke, the Alexander R. and Métis Morrison Professor of Law at Berkeley. We are here today to celebrate his scholarship, not with idle praise, although praise is due, but by engaging it intellectually and seeking to advance our understanding of the issues that he discusses. Not everyone here agrees with Phil's conclusions, and some of the disagreements may run deep, but everyone agrees on the significance of his work. Because Phil's work spans several fields, we will have panels on constitutional law, statutory interpretation, and Indian law. We have, I think, by any measure, an incredible group of participants in this symposium. I wanted also to mention two people who were very much hoping to be here today, but are unable to participate because President Obama is dragging them away from their academic careers, at least temporarily. Cass Sunstein, who clerked with Phil, has been nominated to be the head of the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs at OMB, while Beth Garrett, Phil's co-author, has been selected to be Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for tax policy. Both of them were bitterly disappointed that they couldn't be here, but as you see, Phil runs with a fast crowd. Although it's not the main entry by any means on his bibliography, one of my favorites among Phil's articles is still a piece that he published 25 years ago, early in his career. I see Phil wondering what in the world I've selected. This was a tribute to Judge Wisdom entitled, with the subtitle actually, The Judicial Artist as Scholar and Pragmatist. Judge Wisdom, for those of you who don't know, was one of the heroic judges of the Fifth Circuit during the Civil Rights era, who had to courageously confront both public pressure and threats of violence, but who led the quest to bring racial justice to the American South. And what I wanted to do before turning the microphone over to Goodwin Liu, who is moderating the first panel, is just to read you a couple of passages from that article, because I think they capture so much of Phil's view of the law. They are written at an early stage. They're less nuanced than his later writings, but I still think that they capture something really important. So here's the first part from Phil. Here, I think, he says, lies the ultimate tribute to Judge Wisdom. Within the traditions of the law and the institutional constraints of adjudication, he was able to effect substantial progress in bringing Southern minorities and the South in general along with them into a more modern, fairer, and more democratic political realm. He accomplished that not by creating wide-ranging theories of constitutional law, but by careful, scholarly, case-by-case development of an indictment of voting discrimination on the basis of race. Then Phil wrote, Theodore St. Antoine, who was one of Phil's professors at Michigan, was being wise, not flip, when he once commented that logic, so the cliche goes, is not the life of the law. But logic is very much like the DNA of the law, the structural principle without which all is sprawl and muddle. In the voting opinion surveyed in this article, Phil's article, Judge Wisdom used logic, principles, and ideas whose time had come in the slow, exacerbating, friction-making, interstitial process of law reform. And then summing up, Phil said, in the final analysis, a judge is neither solely a scholar nor solely a politician. Judges are complex combinations of those and other elements, and the components of which they consist may sometimes be in great tension. In evaluating a judge, then, one must look not only for genius, but also for pragmatism and humanitarianism, not only for ideas, but also for results. I find this vision of the law and of the role of judges deeply appealing. Not everyone would agree, including some of our speakers today. But in my view anyway, Phil has captured something of supreme importance in these paragraphs and in the scholarship that he has given us in the decades since then, which are rooted in the same vision. I would be remiss if I closed without thanking Dean Edley and the law firm of Fagerty and Benson for their support for this event, and the California Law Review for agreeing to publish the proceedings in a special issue. And I would also be personally remiss if I didn't take this occasion to thank Phil for the profound effect he has had on my own thinking about the law. And now, with the torch lit and the opening ceremonies completed, I was actually going to say let the games begin, but my wife said that that was too flippant. So let us move on to the intellectual feast. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Goodwin Liu, and I'm a member of the faculty at Bolt Hall and one of Phil's colleagues. At Bolt, Phil teaches one of the most well-subscribed, popular, and well-received classes, and that is legislation. Every year, throngs of students fill the class to hear Phil talk about the famous Ricky Funnel, as well as sundry other subjects, and that is, for many, I think, a memorable experience. Legislation, I think, is, for Phil, a kind of narrow frame in which you can peer into a whole vast canvas of writing about a multitude of other subjects. You know, the term legislation conjures to mind a bunch of Latin maxims, canons of construction, etc. But in Phil's hands, it is a window into understanding constitutional law, administrative law, federal courts, the separation of powers, the interface between law and politics, between process and outcomes, between the court and the legislature. And it's on this broad canvas that so many of Phil's most important contributions have been made. Just a couple examples of things that I've read that I have found particularly instructive for my own work. I remember one of Phil's recent articles in the California Law Review on the avoidance canon, in which he explained how the Warren Court, known for its sort of muscular excursions into the elaboration of constitutional rights, used actually in early times a much more modest form, a more lawyerly formed of statutory interpretation through use of the avoidance canon to achieve many of the important fundamental steps necessary to protect individual liberty at a time when the court was extremely politically vulnerable. Wonderful window into how constitutional lawmaking occurs through statutory interpretation. And his book in earlier years, I think in the 1990s, with Dan Farber on public choice, in which Phil talked a great deal with Dan about the whole notion of due process of lawmaking and the ways in which courts, without sort of overstepping their authority in terms of substantive judicial review, can nonetheless discipline the work of legislatures towards a more rational, coherent, and ultimately a legitimate process. These themes, I think, will be amplified by our speakers today, and I think it's testament to the high regard in which Phil is held by his colleagues that we have three enormously productive and highly respected scholars of constitutional law and statutory interpretation with us here today. I'm going to introduce them with just the briefest of titles. You have other information about them in your materials. To my immediate right is Bill Eskridge from Yale Law School, where he's the John A. Garver Professor of Jurisprudence and a co-author with Phil on many a project, including the book on legislation. Seated next to him is Ernie Young, who's a professor of law at Duke Law School and a well-read scholar in federal courts as well as constitutional law. And seated next to him is Robert Post, who is the David Boies Professor of Law at Yale Law School, and no stranger to these parts because Robert used to be on the Bullitt Hall faculty. So what we're going to do is spend maybe 30 minutes, a little bit more, in the prepared presentations that each of the speakers has, and then we'll do maybe 30 minutes of moderated discussion among those of us up here, and then we'll spend the last 30 minutes in discussion among all of us with your questions and responses. So with that, why don't we start with Bill?
I'm going to get an opportunity to deliver some personal remarks about Phil at lunch. But let it be said that most of our work has been in statutory interpretation. But I've been asked to participate in the constitutional law panel, and I think there's a deep relationship, as Professor Liu suggested. Now, I want to take as my text Proposition 8. So Phil Fricke and the jurisprudence of Proposition 8. Now, that might seem like an odd couple to many of you. It's not a same-sex couple. For many of you, wonder, well, Phil had nothing to do with Proposition 8. He might not even have voted for it. And so what relationship does the jurisprudence of Phil Fricke have for Proposition 8? And I shall now demonstrate. The marriage cases in 2008, as most of you well know, the California Supreme Court, in a pathfinding opinion, interpreted the California Constitution to invalidate the exclusion of lesbian and gay couples from the institution of civil marriage. As you also surely know, in November of 2008, several months later, the voters, by a decisive but small margin, ratified Proposition 8 and added to the California Constitution a definition of civil marriage as limited to one man and one woman. Not surprisingly, the day that vote occurred, a petition was filed with the California Supreme Court by the Pro-Marriage Coalition challenging Proposition 8 as inconsistent with the California Constitution, specifically Article 18, where the California Constitution distinguishes between changing it through an amendment that can be done by a popular petition and then a majority vote, versus a revision which has to be done by a recommendation from the legislature with a supermajority, then followed by a popular vote. And so the argument is that the challengers contend that this was properly a revision which went through the wrong process. It must be a more deliberative process with more supermajoritarian hurdles. The supporters of Proposition 8, represented very ably by Ken Starr, who I think is also a dean here in California, and Attorney General Jerry Brown, a Yale graduate, argue that Proposition 8 was in fact an amendment and therefore proper under Article 18. But the Attorney General, not Ken Starr, the Attorney General argued further that Proposition 8 is invalid because it takes away an inalienable right. And one might refer, though he does not, to the German Constitution's idea of an unconstitutional constitutional amendment. Now, I think for casebook authors such as Phil and Dan and me, this is a fabulous case, however the Supreme Court rules. The marriage cases themselves are fabulous. And that's going in our chapter on fundamental rights and discrimination. And then this case is fabulous because it poses the great question, what is a constitution for, right? So this is something that con law professors ought to want to talk about. And it seems to me, one way of approaching it, maybe that's not the smartest, but one way of approaching it is you see in the various debates, there are three meta-theories of constitutionalism that are set forth. And I think all are very serious theories. So for theory number one, the theory that will probably prevail is Ken Starr's theory. And I think it's an Aristotelian theory. He doesn't cite Aristotle, of course not. But it's an Aristotelian kind of theory. And that is the Constitution is an expressive or descriptive document. Aristotle said it's a document, Aristotle didn't consider it a document. It's a constitution of the life of the city. And in Proposition 8, Starr argues, the Californians have adopted a tolerant but normative stance where lesbian and gay couples have legal rights and duties of marriage via domestic partnership, but not the full normative weight of civil marriage. And this perspective, of course, is open that in the future, the Constitution of California, the small c Constitution, will evolve toward full acceptance of gay and lesbian couples. It may indeed do that. So one theory is this Aristotelian theory. A second theory represented by the pro-marriage forces, Shannon Minter argued the case, is Elysian, John Hart Ely. And that is the Constitution is a normative document, particularly protecting the rights of minorities. Proposition 8, according to this argument, is a revision because it takes away a fundamental right from a minority, gays and lesbians, traditionally subject to social prejudice, pervasive and violent state discrimination. Under these circumstances, the Elysian argument goes more deliberation or higher hurdles are required before the voters can take away this fundamental right. And then a third argument, it seems to me, is Jerry Brown's argument. Jerry Brown, a former Jesuit seminarian, makes a natural law kind of argument, though I'll launder it through Thomas Jefferson. And that is, this argument suggests that the Constitution is for setting forth inalienable rights for all citizens, Declaration of Independence kind of stuff. Civil marriage, the court held in the marriage cases, is a fundamental personal, or Jerry Brown would say, natural right, and hence an inalienable right under the current California Constitution. According to Jerry Brown, the voters cannot delete such rights from the Constitution, at least not for a minority. Maybe they can create a new Constitution, and Brown reserved the issue whether they can do it by an amendment. Now, that's the debate. It seems to me in the Proposition 8 case. And you can frame it a lot of different ways, but you see, a lot is at stake. And it's much more than just gay marriage. It's really what is a constitution for. Now, what does Phil Fricke have to say about this? He's written literally at least a dozen articles that I think illuminate the debate that they're having in this case, though I'm not aware that he's addressed Proposition 8. Now, what I'm going to present is not necessarily what Phil Fricke believes, but what I draw from his work, which, by the way, is going to be inconsistent with my own thinking and with the brief that I actually filed in the Proposition 8 case, though I'm inclined to think that Phil is right and not I. Lesson one, to the surprise of no one in this room, is practical. Phil's notion of practical reasoning, and I've listed a whole bunch of articles, and I could list books and articles in addition to this. And it seems to me Phil would say the debate, what is the Constitution for? It's a lot like the certs debate. Many of you remember from the 90s, a debate that divided the country was whether the certs was a candy mint or a breath mint. Many Frickian scholars concluded that it was actually both. And it seems to me that Phil Fricke would say the debate among the Aristotelian, Elysian, and Jeffersonian points of view is like the certs debate. Constitutions have multiple purposes. Constitutions, or to use a Fricke metaphor taken from Peirce, is like a chair with three legs. Constitution is descriptive, but it's also sometimes representation reinforcing and sometimes creating libertarian floors. Now, for institutional reasons, Phil would be particularly skeptical that judges will single-mindedly press either Elysian or Jeffersonian points of view for very long. Indeed, as a practical institutional matter, courts will probably not press the Constitution too far ahead of popular opinion, as Phil argued in his Harvard Foreword in 1994. And unfortunately, as Phil has also pointed out, this notion has special bite for a Constitution, not the U.S. Constitution, but the California Constitution, that not only provides for amendment by direct popular vote, this is not a Madisonian idea, this is you all here in California, but also provides for popular ouster of justices, as Rose Byrd would remind you. Okay? So that's lesson number one. is that the practical, popular Aristotelian constitution is going to have bite, particularly in a direct democracy such as California, where the judges can be ousted. Now, here's point number two, which Professor Liu very nicely pointed to. And this is the fricky theme of the interconnection between constitutionalism and canons. Confronted with strong public opinion on one side and constitutional principle on the other, the US Supreme Court often mediates them through constitutional canons, like the McCarthy era that Goodwin pointed to. Essentially, using canons to do big C constitutional work can operate as a remand to the legislature to consider these large C constitutional values. And this is indeed the missing argument in the Proposition 8 case. An argument could be made to use the avoidance canon. Why shouldn't we urge the California Supreme Court interpret the California Constitution, Article 18, this revision amendment distinction, to avoid needless conflict with the US Constitution and its equality guarantees? Reitman versus Mulkey could be a good site, where the California Supreme Court, under US constitutional grounds, not the canons, struck down an anti-race amendment back in the 1960s. However, as Phil would drearily remind us, it is not clear that the avoidance canon should apply in full force to popular initiatives, because the remand does not make as much sense because voters don't have to give reasons, and unlike the legislature, are not a continuous institution. Also, as a practical matter, Phil would point out that an Article 18 revision would be impossible on this particular issue, same-sex marriage. Lesson number three, and that is Phil's concern, particularly in the Harvard Forward and his more recent Yale article and then the McCarthy article in California, that aggressive canons might be a troubling stealth constitutionalism. And that is an aggressive use of constitutional canons to reflect Elysian or Jeffersonian values risks frustrating the voters' expressed preferences, as you all did here in California last year, and not giving them their due, to use Phil's kind of language, and perhaps without an honest discussion of the constitutional values at stake. Also, in fairness, it might be implausible to think that the current US Supreme Court would have a constitutional problem with Proposition 8. So here's what Fricke would say, in my opinion, at least if you read his work. There might be a more modest canonical mediation, and that is the anti-retroactivity canon on which Phil has also written. And that is maybe one resolution, and this indeed is the one pointed to by Attorney General's brief, is to allow Proposition 8, at least as an amendment, but interpret it narrowly not to invalidate the marriages that occurred here in the state between June and November 2008. Like the Warren Court in the 1950s, the California court could avoid popular wrath while at the same time taking some of the edge off of the short-term popular reactions. And also, and I think this is what they will do probably in the Supreme Court of California, if they do recognize these marriages that did legally occur last year, it will have the small advantage, but maybe one that will accrue over time, of creating conditions for falsification of stereotypes. In other words, with valid same-sex marriages here in California in the thousands, the traditional stereotype, and this is the deepest, in my opinion, anti-gay stereotype, of lesbians, gay men, bisexuals, and transgendered people as predatory against children and as deeply and fundamentally anti-family. And having the choreography of actual married couples, which I think the California Supreme Court will recognize, is a living and walking refutation to that stereotype, perhaps setting up a future initiative that would overturn Proposition 8 in one of these future elections. Phil Fricke is a brilliant constitutional thinker. And you get the picture.
Well, I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be here. Anytime someone of my moderate stature gets put on a panel with Bill Eskridge and Robert Post, one starts to wonder what one is doing there. And I am basically someone that Phil was very nice to in the appointments process. I think a lot of people can tell that story, but somebody ought to, because Phil has to be the best appointments chair of all time, in my view. You can maybe get out. Circumstances sometimes intervene and one may not accept the offer, but when there is no way to avoid being recruited into the fraternity of people who love Phil Fricke. But I think the other thing I may be able to contribute to this panel is a sense of Phil's influence on a younger generation of scholars in American public law. He and Bill Eskridge and others, including others here, have preserved and elaborated the legal process tradition handed down in the 1950s. And passed it on to another generation. I think the brilliance of their elaboration of that tradition in the present day has made it a viable option for people like me to pursue. And that has been a very fruitful avenue in my own work. And I'm here to pay testimony to that and try to use that framework to play out some concerns that can be traced through a lot of Phil's work. And so I want to talk about the continuity of statutory and constitutional interpretation. I want to start by talking about two problems in statutory construction. One is that we have various canons, including the canon of constitutional avoidance, but also various clear statement rules that cannot be justified within the standard account of statutory construction. So take the canon of constitutional avoidance. The traditional account of statutory construction in our legal culture rests on legislative supremacy and the idea that judges are supposed to be faithful agents of the legislature. And the canons, like the avoidance canon, really don't make a whole lot of sense in that paradigm, because there is no reason to believe that a rational Congress would prefer to have their statutes interpreted in a way other than the one they probably most likely intended, simply because there's a doubt that if a constitutional issue were reached, a court might strike it down. This is particularly true when the rational legislature would know that there is also a second canon that if the court reaches the constitutional issue and finds that the statute is unconstitutional, then they can impose a saving construction. So why in the world would a legislature prefer for courts to veer off away from a constitutional doubt when it remains simply a doubt? And there's a considerable literature attacking the avoidance canon on this ground, that it can't possibly be an adequate description of what the legislature actually intended. And the case is even easier to make against the various clear statement rules, for instance, the various federalism protective clear statement rules, that there's no reason to believe that these are rules that Congress would have intended for the courts to adopt. They don't represent a best guess at Congress's intentions when they don't make themselves clear. And so they have to be justified on some other grounds. The best justification for them is normative, I believe, and that's the conclusion that Phil has reached in his own work. These canons make most sense when we are operating in areas where it's difficult to draw constitutional lines in a hard and fast way, when the constitutional norms are under-enforced, say the norms protecting federalism or the norms protecting against excessive delegations of legislative authority. And that raises the second problem, which is that we may not do this nearly enough if those are the case, because we have lots of areas of constitutional law in which the norms are under-enforced and the lines are very hard to draw. And yet the court seems, in certain cases, to be backing away from the avoidance canon. I think of the Boumediene case, for instance, where I think there was an easy argument to construe the statute to avoid the constitutional doubt, and yet the court embraced the opportunity to strike down a restriction on jurisdiction stripping for the first time since Reconstruction. I think about Justice Thomas's opinion in the Gonzales versus Raich case, which is the case about the Oregon right to die statute and whether it was preempted by federal law. In a previous case, the court had refused to limit Congress's power to reach medical decisions like this in the medical marijuana case, and so Thomas, dissenting in the Right to Die case, said, well, look, if we're not going to enforce the Constitution in these cases, if we're not going to enforce the limits of the Commerce Clause, then the Constitution is out the window. And in construing the statutes, there's no point in interpolating federalism values into our interpretation of what Congress meant. Those are two completely different exercises. And so the second problem that I want to highlight is simply the Court's maybe underappreciation of the usefulness of these canons. So what I'd like to do is try to go back to this legal process paradigm that Phil has elaborated and develop a little more of a case for that. The basic legal process paradigm, which has been played out in many different places, an intermediate acknowledgement of both the indeterminacy of the law and the distinctiveness of law from politics, other elements, sensitivity to the institutional environment, considerations of comparative institutional competence, the notion that law is purposive, that legislators are reasonable people acting reasonably, and then laws have purposes that should be considered in the elaboration of the law, and then the reasoned elaboration of the law over time. But I want to focus on the institutional framework in which this paradigm operates, and a couple of elements in particular that Phil has stressed. First is the Hart and Sachs notion that the rules of statutory construction really are part of constitutional law, that when we are elaborating the purposes of the legislature, we should consider them to be constrained by the underlying constitutional purposes that we find in the underlying document. The second is more the Hart and Wexler point of the legal process school, that constitutional and statutory rules are part of the same structure. So if you think about the standard course in federal courts, sure, you spend a lot of time on Article III of the Constitution and other canonical parts of the constitutional text, and yet at the same time you construe those pieces of law alongside other statutory pieces like the Anti-Injunction Act or the General Federal Question Statute or the Rules of Decision Act. And you come to see all of those pieces, both the constitutional pieces and the statutory pieces, as fitting one coherent structure that has an underlying purpose and coherence to it. And then finally, you see constitutional law evolving in response to political, social, and constitutional pressure, which is reflected not only in the interpretation of the constitutional text, but also in the development of the statutory provisions that go along it, beside it. And I want to suggest that this is all to the good, because if we think about, to borrow Bill's topic for a moment, what constitutions are for, then I think we see that the parts of our law that do these things that constitutions are for are not just the constitutional text, but also the surrounding statutory and regulatory environment. So, for instance, I would advance a more constitutive notion of what constitutions are for, not just recognizing rights, for instance, but also establishing the institutions of the government. Certainly limiting the bounds of those institutions by recognizing rights, and then finally regulating the ways in which these rules can be changed over time. And if you think about the parts of our law that do that, I think you'll see very quickly that it's not simply the constitutional text that performs these functions. Think about the voting rules in the House and Senate, for instance, which are terribly important to the way the government operates, but not in the Constitution. The structure of the administrative state, the vast majority of our government, nowhere in the Constitution, all set forth in statutes. The boundaries between federal power and state power are increasingly set by statutes and regulations, as in the Oregon Right to Die case, and not simply by constitutional rules. The constitutional rules have very little bite, as the recent Commerce Clause decisions, I think, demonstrate. The same thing is true about what boundaries we think of as constitutional between the president and Congress. The dominant constitutional test in that area is that the president can do what Congress has authorized him to do and is forbidden to do what Congress has forbidden, and the rest of the case inevitably involves trying to figure out what Congress authorized the president can do. So in that environment, I think that has profound interpretations for the legitimacy of the canons, and this is to return to Phil's basic concern. And here I want to disagree respectfully with the notion that canons are improper forms of stealth constitutionalism. I would return, first of all, to the Hardin Sachs point that interpretive rules simply are part of the Constitution. Phil's recent work, the Joe DeGene piece, quotes Justice Frankfurter as saying that the avoidance canon, for instance, is a rule of constitutional adjudication, not something that you think about on the way to constitutional adjudication or to avoid constitutional adjudication, but a rule of constitutional adjudication itself. And I would say that the same thing is true of the various clear statement rules. Phil has written that the avoidance canon mediates the boundary between constitutional law and statutory interpretation. But I think I would emphasize the aspect of that role that ties those two things together, because these canons are how the underlying constitutional values make their way into the statutory structure. And the second point I would like to make about that is that the development of these rules, consistent with the legal process paradigm, ought to be purposive, and it ought to be based on constitutional purposes, not simply the local purposes of the statutes involved. And so the clear statement rules on incursions on federalism, on excessive delegation of executive authority, on protection of particular individual rights, as in the 1950s McCarthy era cases, these are instances of the court infusing statutory schemes with underlying constitutional values, which is legitimate because all of these things are continuous, because the statutes themselves are playing constitutive roles in the creation of the structure. It makes sense that the structure's underlying values should be part of their construction. And so as an example of that, I think I would give various efforts to integrate constitutional law and statutes into the constitutional structure. So here I think of Justice Thomas on a better day in his concurrence in Wyeth versus Levine, where for the first time Justice Thomas articulates, Wyeth versus Levine is a preemption case about the scope of the power of federal agencies, in particular to preempt state tort law. And Justice Thomas writes a concurrence about how preemption is the central issue of federalism in our time and a crucial aspect of the dividing line between federal and state power. And so the rules for preemption, the rules of construction, ought to be construed with that in mind. Now, one of the reasons the legal process school continues to appeal, I think, is that it's open to people with different agendas. And my agenda with these canons may not be Phil's agenda, I suspect. But I would argue that this sort of integration of statutory construction and constitutional construction is essential if we want to maintain the structural part of our Constitution, which has been neglected in a lot of current constitutional law. If you want to protect federalism, you need to do it in the construction of statutes, because the constitutional firebreaks have largely fallen by the wayside. If you want to protect separation of powers in an environment where there is pressure both coming from the superior expertise of administrative agencies and the complexity of the problems that they have to confront, and also from the pressure of national security concerns on the terrorism side, in those situations it's hard to justify a strong role for the legislature as against these concerns. And so I think the best way for courts to mediate that conflict is going to be much as they did in the 1950s through the canons of construction. The last thing I want to say in conclusion is that the legal process school had an idealized image of legislators as reasonable people pursuing reasonable ends in a reasonable manner. I would suggest that that idealized picture, ladies and gentlemen, is a pretty good description of Phil Fricke.
For our discussion after, okay, now there we go. Okay. Robert?
Thank you. So first let me say it's lovely to be home again. And second, let me say what a privilege and an honor it is to be here in tribute to Phil. And the best way I know to give tribute is to think about a problem that Phil has thought about throughout his writings and to wrestle with him on this problem. And that is the problem of the relationship between law and politics. And I'm one of the people in this conference who happens to agree wholeheartedly with almost everything that Phil writes. So his conclusion is this, that and I'm quoting him now, no sharp disjunction can be legislated between law and life, between judge and context, between neutrality and value. Law without life is no more functional to a thriving society than would be life without law. That's Phil, and I think that's, I subscribe to this wholeheartedly. Notice a number of points can be made about the law-politics boundary out of that passage. The first is that there is a boundary. Law and politics are distinct. Second, that the boundary is contested. We don't know exactly where it is. And third, that contestation about the relationship between law and politics is healthy. It enlivens the law and it enlivens politics. And what I'd like to do in the next few moments is to think about that picture of the relationship between law and politics and how we might conceive of law and politics such that we can sustain it. That is to say, we can sustain a picture of a contested boundary in which politics inform law and law informs politics. How do we need to conceive law and politics for that to happen? And I want to use as my focus the article that already so many people have talked about on this panel, the article about the avoidance canon, getting from Joe to Jean McCarthy. And the avoidance canon, as you've heard now, is the canon which says we're going to interpret a statutory provision so as to avoid a constitutional problem. And Phil examines these relatively anonymous Warren Court cases to show how they managed to speak for important constitutional values like freedom of speech in the face of McCarthyite repression through the technical craft of interpreting the statutes through this avoidance canon. And as Phil examines the use of this canon, he concludes, and I'm quoting him now, it is a tool of public law on the borderline between constitutional law and subconstitutional law and between judicial and legislative functions. And what I want to focus on is between judicial and legislative functions. He's saying that the court here properly imagines its own functioning as somewhere between a legislature and a court. And that's a good thing, says Phil, because it joins, in his words, legal craftsmanship to judicial statesmanship. He wants to join those two things together. And I also want to join those two things together. But what I want to question is how we can do that. How can we have it both ways, such that the court can be both legislative and judicial? What's our picture of law, constitutional law, such that that works? And I want to say, in Phil's writing on this subject, in this article, there's an ambivalence about this union. Phil imagines the court doing this, and he praises the court for doing it, but he sees it at the same time as the loss of some kind of purity or innocence or law for law's own sake. And there's an elegiac and almost a nostalgic tone in his characterization of the court doing this when he says, for example, that the court interprets these statutes, quoting him now, less neutrally than constitutional text, structure, and history require. So the loss is the loss of a pure kind of legal craftsmanship, which would be what? Which would be neutral. So the image of law and politics that's underlying this article is one that one sees instantly goes back to Wexler's famous article toward neutral principles of law that has informed, and I want to say now confused, legal scholars since 1959. And the question that I want to pursue is, what is that boundary, according to Wexler, that is influencing Phil's account in this article, and can we give a different one? So Wexler attempts to draw this article by saying, what are politics? Politics, he says, are naked power organs. That's his language. And what is the law? He says, the legal quality of judicial decision inheres primarily in what they are or are obliged to be entirely principled. A principled decision is one that rests on reasons with respect to all the issues in the case, reasons that in their generality and their neutrality transcend any immediate result that is involved. So law politics is law is reason, politics are naked power organs. Now, what are naked power organs? It sounds like an odd phrase, but I think it means by naked and organ that it's bereft of reason, it's bare. And if I use the adjective bare, I hope what you associate to are preferences, bare preferences. The image of politics which Wechsler has in this article is the image of politics one sees in rational choice theory, Pareto optimality, welfare, interest group politics. Politics is the arena for the aggregation of bare preferences. Preferences are bare because they're not controlled by reason. They're exogenous and given to the person. We have subjective little balls of persons who run around, and somehow out of that becomes the force of politics. That's the image of politics. It very much informs political science and informs much legal reasoning about the political sphere. And what's law in opposition to that? It's reason. Well, we can see why you would have an opposition between law and politics, because we don't want preferences to distort reason. It would be a mistake for judges to act from desire, from preference. It would corrupt the law. So you have a law of politics, and in point of fact, we need to keep it that way. And that's the function of the distinction which Wechsler draws. So what is the reason of law? When we say on the other side of the boundary is law, it's reason. What is reason? Well, reason could mean simply you have a reason for doing something. And if that's all you mean, it's not very determinative of anything. And also, it's plainly false to say that politicians don't have reasons. Of course they have reasons. Obama gives a speech, he gives a reason. McCain gives a speech, he gives a reason. Reason in the bare sense, of course, exists on both sides of that divide. So that can't be a contrast. So Wechsler tries to think about what sort of reason is constitutive of law, qua law. And one theme that is in the passage I read to you, I have to go very quickly because I don't have much time, is that the law's reasons are general. But that can't be right because, of course, the specificity of reason is involved in the whole debate over rules and standards, and law sometimes is specific reasons, sometimes more general reasons, and the same is true in politics. So there is no qualitative distinction between generality and not. To have a reason is to be general with regard to a particular case, and that's true in politics and in law. So Wechsler gives us a different account, which is very interesting when you read him carefully. What kind of principles are in law? He says he contrasts it to political men, quoting Wechsler now, who, vouching no philosophy to warrant, frankly or covertly, make the test of virtue in interpretation whether its result in the immediate decision seems to hinder or advance the interests or values they support. So quoting Wechsler again, he warns, quote, "The man who simply lets his judgment turn on the immediate result may not realize that his position implies that courts are free to function as naked power organs." Now, what is that passage? That passage is saying the reasons of law are independent of consequences. They're non-consequentialist. They're deontological. And that's very resonant. Of course, if you think of Weber, right, politics as a vocation, Weber says politicians have an ethic of responsibility for consequences. And he contrasts that to the absolute ethic, despite consequences, of people outside politics. And so there's a resonant notion that if you're going to be principled, you're not going to care. The chips can fall where they may. It doesn't matter what the results are. And Wechsler is appealing to that concept, which we see in Weber, where it's a very common concept. But if you think about it for 2 seconds, can't be right. It can't be that the law only has deontological reasons. It can't be you can't be utilitarian in law. Lots of legal rules depend on consequences. We say, make a rule so as not to chill speech. Make a rule so you can't have disproportionate violence. Make a rule so freedom of contract can be efficient, or whatever it is. Lots of legal rules have consequentialist implications, just like they do in politics. So that can't be a ground. And yet it's very deep in the Wechsler notion of what it is to be a legal principle. There's another theme that Wechsler sounds, which is that the reasons that define law are neutral. So what do we mean by neutral? Neutral is a word that's always defined with respect to a baseline. I'm neutral as between warring parties. So one sense of neutrality is the law is neutral as between partisans and advocates in a lawsuit. And that seems right. That what that says is the law applies the law's reasons and not the partisan's reasons, not the party's reasons. So that means apply principles of law neutrally. That's an easy concept. And it's also not very hard. So if you look closely at Wechsler, that's not what he's saying. He's saying not that you apply legal rules neutrally, but that legal rules are neutral. Neutral principles, not apply the principles neutrally. So what's a neutral principle? With respect to what controversy are the principles of law neutral? That is to say, taking no side between a controversy. If the law is neutral with respect to every controversy, then the law is not neutral, it's neutered, which the OED described as castrated or spayed. which is to say impotent, which is to say non-consequential. It turns back to this theme of anti-consequentialism that we saw earlier. We want the law not to have consequences. But who would think that? Why would you want an impotent law? Why would you want a law that served no values, accomplished no purposes, achieved no ends? That makes no sense at all. And yet it's deep in Wexler, and one can see themes of that in Phil's treatment of neutral principles, namely the principles which the chips fall what they may, we do it regardless of consequences. So I think if you adopt this view, the Wexler view, which has all of us in its grip, and its influence is manifest in this article about the avoidance canon, we have a problem combining statesmanship and craftsmanship such that the statesmanship doesn't corrupt the law. We really, it's a difficult problem to solve. So when Phil approaches this, he approaches it actually from a different perspective. He and Bill Eskridge on this panel are masters of the legal process school, and they define and Phil defines the legal process school in this way. I'm reading him now. He says, their approach, Albert Sachs and Henry Hart, their approach understood all law, including the legislature's role in statutory creation and the administrative and judicial roles of statutory implementation and application, as a purposive endeavor designed to promote social utility. They assumed the legislature to be made up of reasonable persons pursuing reasonable purposes reasonably, again, Phil Fricke, and the judges interpreting statutes to be engaged in the reasoned elaboration of those purposes as they could be made to fit within the broader legal fabric. So what is this picture? Notice that in Wexler's picture of politics, one has instrumental reason. One aggregates preferences. One maximizes one's preference fulfillment. But purposes are different than instrumental rationality. Purposes aren't even second-order preferences. Purposes aren't preferences at all. They're deliberate choices. What is the conception of the person that can make a deliberate choice and is not captured by their own preferences? And I suggest that the answer is found in Phil's reference to the notion of reasonableness. A person that has purposes is reasonable, exercises judgment. What does it mean to exercise judgment? It means to apply intersubjective norms, norms that make a we instead of an I, and that define who I am in reference to all of you. And I apply such norms in my attempt to make legal judgments. So underlying the legal process school is a picture of persons who are socialized, who are reasonable, who participate in intersubjective norms, not merely, aren't in the sway of mere exogenous subjective preferences. And so legal actors can apply intersubjective norms. And it's that ground, I would say, that Phil makes explicit when he says, what is interpretation? He says, it is, and I'm quoting him now, the method by which a community, an interpretive community, goes about part of its business. It is only by capturing the broader assumptions about the enterprise that we can make sense out of the lesser included function to be performed by interpretation for that enterprise. So it's exactly what Ernie was saying. You need a definition of the common enterprise in order to do interpretation. It presupposes intersubjectivity. It presupposes reasonableness. Now, the problem with this is, well, if people are so reasonable, how come they disagree in politics? If we're intersubjectively bound, what is all the fuss in politics about? And indeed, the legal process school met its demise with respect to the sharp political controversies of the 60s, where people suddenly started acting, I was one of them, not reasonably, right? They started acting oppositionally and stubbornly and in all sorts of ways that the legal process school couldn't imagine. So the problem with the legal process school is not that it doesn't give us a picture, a coherent picture of what people do inside the law. The problem is it kind of effaces and displaces politics, where controversy and disagreement seem to be rampant. So what would be a picture of disagreement in politics that wouldn't take us all the way back to Wexler's notion of naked power organs, of preference aggregation? Can we have a picture of shared purposes which allows for disagreement in politics? And if I had time, I would speak to you about three thinkers who are addressing that now. One would be Chantal Mouffe, another would be Jacques Rancière, but I'll just be very quick, and I'll just go to Jeremy Waldron, who is a thinker who was just here for the Tanner Lectures, who was trying to theorize this. Waldron says that disagreement is constitutive of politics. Disagreement is to politics as scarcity is to justice. You cannot have politics without disagreement, he says, but nevertheless, politics is not just about the aggregation of preferences. He says, we engage each other in politics in an effort, he says, not merely to, quoting him now, produce an aggregation of what each person brings to the argument, but rather, he says, to promote a process that will bring each citizen's ethical views and insights to bear on the views and insights of the others, providing a basis for reciprocal questioning and criticism and enabling a view to emerge which is better than any of the inputs and much more than a mere aggregation of function of those inputs. So what is he saying? He's saying in politics, one shares certain things. One shares a commitment to the process of politics, for one thing. You have to. Which means it's a form of social solidarity in which people agree to settle their differences through political mechanisms. So it's a form of solidarity in which people strive to convince each other of shared values, but they also know how to live with disagreement. That's a very thin form. But it's not merely aggregation of preferences. It's a form of solidarity which lives with disagreement. Now, if you think about that way of imagining politics, we can rehabilitate this law of politics distinction in the following way. When people talk to each other in politics, they understand that you may disagree with me, we may not reach a consensus, whatever, but we're striving to agree with each other. And when we do, what do? We say we pass a law. And what is it to pass a law? It's to say, we agree about this. And when we look at the legal system, it's a system of professional discourse, unlike politics, which means what goes in to legal decision making is filtered by professional norms of argumentation and practice. We have precedent. We know what forms of legal authority count and don't count, whereas politics is a free-for-all. It's a big difference. And second, the discourse of the law is one designed to entrench and articulate the value which presumably was shared in the legislature, right? So when we give a reason for something in law, we're foregrounding the values which we share in exactly the way Phil is describing on the premise that we in fact share this value. Whereas when that value exists in politics, it's merely up for grabs, it's up for agreement or not agreement, and we may not agree. Now, how do we imagine the law of politics boundary on that account? Well, what you're seeing is two phases of forms of social integration. One phase in which we agree to have a common polity. We agree to engage in politics with each other, which is no small thing, by the way. Not killing each other, not being a Schmittian sense of friend and enemy, not being what Chantal Mouffe calls antagonist, where I want to eliminate you. I don't want to eliminate you. I want to live with you, but I also want to convince you, and I also will live with you even if you disagree with me. So that's a form of social solidarity, which is striving for a greater degree of integration. When we achieve that degree of integration, we have certain forms of social solidarity, like administration or law, which are designed to put that agreement to the forefront, to make it systematic, to make it transparent, to entrench it, and to make it as patent as it's possible to be. So there is a law politics divide on this account. Second, the boundary between law and politics on this account is always controversial. Why? Because from the political side, we never know whether we agree enough to make a law. And we never know when somebody in the legal field has made a decision whether they made the right decision about our values. So maybe you want to take it back as a political question, like Prop 8, you know, takes it away politically from a legal decision. Or from the legal side, we claim to have agreement. That's the premise of deciding a question according to the legal method. But actually, the underlying agreement may not be there. So from the legal perspective, you have to know whether a subject is ripe for the kind of agreement that law presupposes, or whether making a legal decision will put a question back into the vortex of politics. So that means you're going to have a phased interaction of these values, a phased dynamic between law and politics and law and politics. So we get together, we say we should end racial discrimination in the workplace. Highly controversial, a lot of political disagreement. We finally reach, we overcome the filibuster, we pass the Civil Rights Act of 64, it becomes a law. And then courts have to enforce the law on the assumption that we agree. But courts enforce it. It doesn't take away the disagreement that it's within the professional language of law. It can become equally controversial if they make the wrong decisions, and in fact, they do. And so it comes back to a political question, should the statute be amended? And then they amend it and make a new law, a new agreement, right? So you have a constantly cycling thing between law and politics. And the same thing is true in constitutional law. Reva Siegel and I have called this democratic constitutionalism, but the court decides a case, like an abortion case, it sets off a politics. Some people, like Cass Sunstein, say constitutional decisions foreclose politics. Actually, decisions prompt politics. Roe has prompted a politics of abortion, which in turn has changed the law of abortion, which in turn changes the politics of abortion, and so forth. So you have a boundary, it is permeable, and what's more, if you're on the legal side of it, which is where we started, what do I need to take account of to do my job well? I need to know when the underlying forms of social agreement are such that when I decide a case legally, I'm not going to prompt another political, I'm not going to dissolve the law, I'm not going to undermine the law and shove the issue back into politics. And one name for that is statesmanship. And this means that craft and statesmanship are two sides of the same coin. They're not opposite. It's not an oxymoron to talk about craftsmanship and statesmanship. It is, in fact, the thing itself, if I've given a correct picture of the law-politics distinction. Thanks.
Well, we have enough to work with here, I think. Let me begin with one question for the entire panel. And I'll just make a more pedestrian observation. The public, everyday citizens, are very invested in all these concepts that we've spent the last hour critiquing and in some ways tearing down. The public believes very deeply in a distinction between law and politics. The public thinks that courts should interpret the intent of the legislature and believes that that is what courts do when they construe statutes. The public believes that, judges should, in general, sublimate their own preferences to something called reason, principle, etc. These observations would be pedestrian and simply wrong on some accounts, if it weren't for the fact that it's the case that these conceptions contribute to some degree to the stability and the legitimacy of the system. And so, what do we do with that? That's my question to everyone who has spoken so far. What do we do with that, these popular conceptions of these distinctions? Do we just simply say to those people, sorry, you're wrong, you don't really understand the way things work? Or do we say, interesting, that means that courts should be much more transparent about what they are doing when they say, oh, we're interpreting statutes. No, you're not really interpreting statutes. What you're doing is you're making constitutional law through subconstitutional means, and you should sort of write that out so people understand what's actually happening and can, through the system, hold people accountable for what's actually happening. But no, courts don't do that. They say, no, we're just interpreting the intent of the legislature, et cetera, et cetera. And so the court itself is very deeply invested in these rather more pedestrian notions. And that, too, is a kind of data point signaling that something very important is going on in these rather more pedestrian understandings. Right? So that's the question I have, is what do we do with that on these, I think, in many ways, much more persuasive accounts of what is actually going on. Go ahead.
Well, Gordon, I think that's a good one. I think that's a great question. There's a recent book that actually addresses that. Nathan Persily, who's an empiricist, I think Columbia now, did a book where the big conclusion of the book is that Americans, the average American, wants judges to interpret the Constitution and statutes as written and constrained by this objective stuff, but they also want the judges to come out with answers for important questions that the people agree with, right? And this is a central finding, and this is, it seems to me, a central tension. Now, it seems to me that I am, like Robert, I'm like an unequivocal fan of Phil. And I think the way you mediate this tension is pragmatic. And so, to use the Proposition 8 case, it's very topical. It seems to me that a lot of this is about pluralism. And this is one of the many links between politics and law, is that ours is not just a democratic system, but it's also a pluralist system. It is a system with a lot of different groups, and the groups define themselves differently over time. When I was growing up, there was no such thing as a gay and lesbian group. They were called criminals, but that's not a social group, etc. And today, in California, gay men, bisexuals, and transgender people are a group, a small group, but a group that is socially respectable and that's engaged in all of this. There's another group, the traditional family values people. And they didn't exist in the same way when I was growing up. You know, this is a change that is cultural. So actually, I would say it's not just politics and law, but it's culture that has changed. And so it seems to me that a lot of this is cultural. So take the gay marriage issue. It seems to me that a sort of a pragmatic approach to that is that the courts are very limited, and indeed any legal actor is very limited, into how much they can push the envelope beyond which the culture is ready. So for example, everybody in this room knows it would be inconceivable for the Alabama Supreme Court to have written the decision that the California Supreme Court did last year in the marriage cases, even if exactly the same individuals, in fact, more enlightened individuals, sat in the Alabama Supreme Court, which is conceivable, though not likely. And the reason is entirely cultural, is that in Alabama there would be riots in the streets. And there, Judge Wisdom encountered this. They would not just be hanged in effigy, they would be hanged, period. You know, just full stop. And even in California, I think that's going to explain what the California Supreme Court ultimately does, which is they're willing to reverse the burden of inertia on the gay marriage issue. And indeed, the Attorney General did the pro-marriage forces a great favor when he basically phrased the ballot proposition, as I understand it, didn't vote in California, as, you know, rather than should we adopt something new called gay marriage, the Attorney General said, no, we're going to phrase it, should we take away this right that people now have? You know, it's the offer-asking dilemma. And, you know, yet the pro-marriage forces still lost by a narrow but decisive margin. Well, I think the California Supreme Court is going to be very reluctant to then invalidate it. And Ernie, here's what I want to say. I'm going to take this question to respond to Ernie. Here's what Phil is talking about when he talks about stealth constitutionalism. Here's what's deeply objectionable from your point of view as well as mine and certainly from Phil's. What Phil is talking about in stealth constitutionalism is not this divide where there's permeability between these rules of statutory interpretation and constitution. That's, I think, his main point. I think that's Phil's main point in several of his articles. Instead, what Phil's concern is, it's the progression, for example, from Gregory, in fact, that's the exact example that he uses, from Gregory, where you start off with this clear statement rule, super clear statement rule, that we shouldn't leap to presume that Congress wants to directly regulate the states as states, to then Lopez, which comes shortly after Phil wrote the Harvard foreword, where the court says, well, we're going to strike this down, but because there's been no deliberation. And then to Morrison, where there was gobs of deliberation, the Violence Against Women Act, Vice President Biden's statute, gobs of deliberation, an urgent public problem, you know, protecting the rights, fundamental Hobbesian rights. These are Hobbesian rights. These are like physical protection. This is Hobbes. This is not Montesquieu or Voltaire. This is Hobbes. VAWA is a Hobbesian statute. And yet the Supreme Court has the asperity. This is a grotesque act of constitutional activism, big C constitutional activism. And that's what Phil's concerned about. And I think in the marriage cases, this is a valid concern for someone who's very pro-marriage. I'm very pro-gay marriage. So this comes from somebody who's deeply committed to this issue. I've been writing on this for 20 years. But from a pro-marriage point of view, there is a genuine concern that Frickian jurisprudence, it sounds like a Wagner opera, that Frickian jurisprudence would have about a Supreme Court decision that says, okay, so we're not going to interpret the Constitution for gay marriage. And they say in that opinion, And by the way, of course, the voters can respond to this. So then the voters do one of these constitutional amendments through the initiative process, and they vote for it decisively. There's no controversy about chads and whatnot, or even chads marrying other chads. It's undisputed that this is a narrow victory for the pro-Prop 8 forces. And then the courts say, well, okay, but that was the wrong process, and now you guys got to go through the legislature, which of course has twice voted for gay marriage. They're going to give you 2/3 majorities to override this. So basically frustrating the popular will. And that's a kind of stealth constitutionalism. Not only because there's a sneakiness about it, but also because it's not going to be an honest debate. The danger is it wouldn't be an honest debate. You know, say, oh, this is revision, and then you look up in the dictionary, and then you parse some cases. Say, oh, well, this is the wrong category. When in fact, it's a deep normative issue. Now, here's one final point, and this is, it seems to me, a theme in Phil's scholarship that Phil hasn't written about very explicitly, and that is the pluralism stuff. I think a lot of this is cultural, and I think it's a lot about pluralism. Robert Dahl, I think, wrote back in the 50s, and this is very relevant for the McCarthy stuff and for the gay marriage stuff, links the two together. Dahl says it's always a challenge for a democracy when there's an issue that intensely but evenly divides the body politic. Now, that issue is often abortion. That's a classic example of that. I think the McCarthyism stuff was an example of that for a while. And I'm afraid that gay marriage is an example of that today. And on those issues, for the court to declare an end to discussion is, from a pragmatic point of view and pragmatic thinking, not just in terms of the judges keeping their jobs and not being turned out, but in terms of the, and this is the deep legal process point, because Hart and Sachs were written in a period when pluralist theory was riding high, like Dahl, this indeed would have negative effects on the operation of the pluralist system itself. It would raise the stakes, the normative stakes of political debate, and it would frustrate a significant minority of the body politic as taking gay marriage off the political agenda would. And I think from the Chief Justice's point of view, Chief Justice George, I think he sincerely believes that, and he'll probably write the opinion, upholding Prop 8, and he probably sincerely believes that, well, of course, the pro-marriage people can always come back. And he probably believes, I personally believe this as well, that they will win at some point. The demographics, there's a guy named Egan and Cheryl have written an article on the best article in terms of the demographics of the vote. And their analysis suggests that there was only one age group that voted in favor of Prop 8. It was the over 65 group. And that other groups, the group that Phil and I are in, narrowly voted against Prop 8, and younger people voted by a little bit larger margins against Prop 8. And so you look at the demographics of it, and it's not inevitable, but it seems likely that a reversal of Prop 8 certainly is going to be possible in the near future in California. And I personally think that if the Chief Justice then, as it looks like he's going to, says this is not retroactive, so we're going to validate the marriages that were entered into between June and November, I think that does, you know, it's as much as you can do on a government salary. Very pragmatic.
So I never realized that what Thomas Hobbes was really writing about was the superiority of a federal forum for a woman with a tort claim to a state forum. But now I should go back and look at Leviathan. I think stealth constitutionalism could mean two quite distinct things. One would be that you simply aren't explaining the constitutional analysis that you're going through, because you say you're not making a constitutional analysis, you say you're just doing statutes, and yeah, there's this clear statement rule, but you're not really serious about getting at the justification for the clear statement rule and what it entails. That would be bad. But I think another thing that's meant in some of these writings, at least, by stealth constitutionalism is when a court interprets away from a reading of a statute that if it reached the constitutional question, it would not hold that statute unconstitutional. So that the constitutional value of federalism, for instance, would have more bite in a statutory case than it would if you actually applied the Commerce Clause, in which case it would have very little bite at all. So the question really is whether a clear statement rule or an avoidance canon can have independent constitutional bite, whether it can actually protect a constitutional value further than just the straight-up interpretation of the underlying constitutional text would go. And that's what I want to argue for. I think there's some discomfort with that in these writings, but also some endorsement of that in these writings. And I want to endorse the endorsement part. The second point I'd make, coming back to Goodwin's question, is to link it to pedagogy, which we haven't talked about much, because the same problem about, you know, a public that thinks of the law and as doing one thing and operating in a particular way that is quite distinct from the professional narrative and the academic narrative, the same thing happens with law students, right? Because law students come in and they think the law operates in a particular way, and what we usually do is tear it down. And it's the easiest way for us to show that we're adding value. You know, here's a case. You already heard their explanation. You know, I'm going to show you how smart I am by picking it apart. And I went to law school under the sway of the critical legal studies people, and that was what we did every day for 3 years, was to take the law apart. I think the legal process perspective that Phil has developed so wonderfully offers a way to kind of put that back together again, to say, you know, this much of the popular narrative is true. There is a distinction between law and politics. On the other hand, and this I think is also a popular intuition, politics plays a role, policy plays a role, and here is a more systematic and thoughtful and nuanced way of integrating those two things together. For one thing, I think it tells you where to look for the values that are coming back into statutory and constitutional interpretation. And in part, that's in the enduring values of the structure and the system. And then the last point, I think, is just, I think, this ability to integrate the professional narrative, the empirical narrative of the political scientists, the popular narrative of how the law works, really is why reasonableness is brilliant. Right? It's not just pedestrian. It's not just, you know, going along, okay, this is the slightly more thoughtful elaboration of the conventional wisdom. It requires a certain brilliance, although not a Dan Farber case against brilliance sort of brilliance, to integrate these three narratives together. And I think that's what Phil has offered us consistently.
A short comment, and then we'll go to the audience, get a few questions.
I think your question is right on the money. There are two people on this faculty, Paul Mishkin and Mark Shapiro, who write a lot about that question. And it reminds me of one of my most favorite moments at Bolt. It was after one of the abortion decisions, like Webster, and some TV cameraman came into my office doing an interview on it. And so I gave the interview, and then he says, okay, we want some stock footage, so I want you to go to your bookshelf and take down your Constitution and point to the abortion clause, he says. So how do you mediate between popular understandings of what the law is and what we teach our students to know about the inside functioning of law? How do we do that? And I don't know what's to be said about that generally, but I can say sociologically that it means that the burden of judging is maintaining trust in the law. And that means if your burden is to maintain trust in legal institutions qua institutions, Phil has to be correct in joining craft to statesmanship. It's that simple. And you could say, well, but then there's no close there. But that's not right either, because in response to Ernie, I think in a law school, we not merely tear down, we build up, we socialize, so that what we produce are people who are fluent in the professional discourse of lawyers. And they don't come in like a pro se plaintiff, if we've done our job. And that's a significant difference.
Okay, questions? I'll gather a few and then we'll come back to the panel. Surely there must be questions. Gentlemen, right here. I think we have microphones because we're taping the proceedings. So why don't you wait till the mic reaches you? And just give us a quick identifier,
sure,
who you are.
All right, I'll bite. David Levine, my connections with Phil are, we were co-clerks on the Fifth Circuit, same floor, and we were on the same baseball team, the Fifth Circuit Federales. We're in the New Orleans Lawyers League. So here's my question. Let me start with Robert. Since Prop 8 is sort of an underlying theme here, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the first case, the case against Gavin Newsom, where the Supreme Court 7-0 slapped him down for, in a way, taking the law in his own hands. And how does that fit into all of this? Was that decision correct? Does that say something about where we might end up with on the third case?
Well, this is a case in which Gavin Newsom refused to reinterpreted California law in light of what he said was a constitutional constraint. The California Supreme Court said, no, it's a ministerial duty, and you have to challenge it separately. So you can imagine this as a question of whether executive officials have to follow the rule of law, and if they have a particular view of law that's contrary, let's say, to common sense, they have a certain procedure they have to follow to challenge it, namely, it's a judicial monopoly. I teach on popular constitutionalism, which is constitutional, an executive, and I think it's an interesting, hard case because the question is, what barrier exactly to entry is there when you have to use one procedure rather than another? And of course, the court can't say much about that except to insist rule of law means you have to obey the law.
Good. Just a brief rejoinder to that. I think that's a great question, but I think it's a question with more than one context. I would look at it as not just Gavin Newsom as the mayor of San Francisco, who does have no authority to be the final word, but it's Gavin Newsom as like an administrative constitutionalist. And there are two points to be made there. One is that the entrepreneurship, this is Robert Cover's point. Robert Cover's point is that law is gnomic killing, that there are all these views of law that are out there, and the role of the Supreme Court is to kill off most of them and to leave one standing. And Newsom was interpreting the California Constitution. He was saying, to me, what that means is that the statutory discrimination against gay and lesbian couples is simply wrong. This is not what our society is, and I'm actually going to do something about it. I'm going to create this choreography of handing out marriage licenses, right? And it's been criticized very sensibly as, well, he was acting outside the law. But it's also been defended as he was creating a media moment where people started talking about gay marriage. But people were moved by this, by getting marriage licenses, even though those marriage licenses were ultimately invalidated. Now, the other thing that's going on with Gavin Newsom is that Gavin Newsom was assuming a role as a spokesperson for a social movement, and this is also Robert Cover, that social movements have their own interpretations of the Constitution, and they should advance them even if they do not think judges will agree with them. So 13, 14 years ago, I wrote a book called The Case for Same-Sex Marriage, and I make all these constitutional arguments. Fundamental right to marry obviously should apply to same-sex couples. It's a sexual orientation discrimination, that ought to be invalid. And I also argued it's a sex discrimination, and that should be invalid. Now, did I think in 1996 or 1994 and 5 when I wrote the book that the Rehnquist court would agree with me? This is in the wake of Bowers versus Hardwick. No, I did not think that. And I also don't think the Roberts court would agree with me. But my point was, this is correct. This will be the law at some point. This will be the either Aristotelian or Elysian understanding of even the Constitution at some point. Just like I was completely confident that Bowers and Hardwick would not remain the law forever. And indeed, it came crashing down. And I think that's also what Gavin Newsom is doing. So I think it's fine. I think the California Supreme Court was right because it segregated the issue of, does the statutory constellation allow Gavin Newsom to do this, from the constitutional issue, the large. So they said, well, as a statutory matter, yeah, he is acting ultra vires. But then they said, I think, which was an act of statesmanship, we're not going to decide the large C constitutional issue yet. Let's wait on that. Let's wait. And this is a great pragmatic virtue, again, of what the Warren Court was doing in the 50s. Let's cool things down. Let's wait. And let's reserve the big issue until there's been some more discussion and some more fallout to people, sort of see where they are. So I think it's a great thing. And I think it's fine that the California Supreme Court, as it probably should have done, said this is ultra vires under the statutes, which did include the Knight Initiative, though I guess that was not the main one. It was mainly a 1977 statute that they'd adopted here in California.
Maybe if Phil has appointments, chair, you should reach out to Gavin Newsom. Other questions?
Or outrage, especially some outrage. Sure, there are people who want Prop 8 struck down.
Dean Edley.
Thanks, Chris Edley, and I work for Phil. Going to the law politics issue and practicality, there's also a very timely issue now with respect to the Obama administration's debate. I guess the way I think of it is a fight that I had during the transition between the folks who were saying with respect to investigation and prosecution of Bush officials, no, we have to move forward, we can't look back, versus my argument, well, I'm not for witch hunts, but I am for the rule of law. So in thinking about what the rule of law would require and how that can or cannot be reconciled with felt political and institutional concerns, on the other hand, how can those be harmonized through institutional invention, through just perpetual conflict? Can a claim really be made that politics ought not trump law?
Well, one way that the legal process school addressed that, and we haven't talked much about this aspect of it yet, is the principle of institutional settlement, that in a pluralistic society, we may not agree on, you know, the good. We may disagree about all kinds of things, and we may disagree about a lot of even legal questions on the merits, but we come up with procedures and allocations of authority institutionally to decide these questions. And we hope that we can agree at least on the legitimacy of the procedures and the institutional allocations, even if we can't necessarily agree on what the answers should be to all the questions those institutions will ultimately confront. And the corollary to that was that when an institution with the right authority to decide something, that should get some kind of presumption, not an irrebuttable presumption, but some sort of presumption of correctness, and that we ought to be willing to support that resolution because it is the legitimate resolution, even if we might not agree on the merits. At least it ought to count as an independent reason in favor of that resolution, that it is the legitimate resolution of the process that we all agreed upon. Now, it might be so wrong that we might overturn it anyway, but it counts for something separate that was the legitimate outcome of the legitimate procedures. And so I guess, you know, my reservation about looking back is wanting to make sure that when we look back, we look at that question as well as not just the question, did we agree with what was done? Which leaves open all sorts of debates about how much deference the settled resolution should get. And I don't, you know, have a well thought out view about that. But I fear that at least some of it is just simple disagreement on the merits with a different set of office holders during a different time. So my concern is that we keep some eye on institutional settlement as we move forward.
Robert, any last
words? Well, the question you raise is analogous to the issues of transitional justice you see around the world. So think of three different cases. The Spanish case, where you have a transition to a democracy, and it's like you have a flourishing democracy with the rule of law, with nothing backward-looking at all. Versus the South African case, where there are what's called extra-legal mechanisms for truth and reconciliation. With a case like Argentina, where there were trials, criminal prosecutions, et cetera, and then legal amnesties. So these diversity of approaches toward establishing the rule of law teach us, I think, that the rule of law is itself a political achievement. And it has to be, how you achieve it is not a matter of what rules you use, it's a matter of understanding where the law and how the law gains legitimacy and force in the circumstances facing you. And there are many different routes to that, and ultimately, in the end, that has to be a political judgment.
We're slightly over, but I want to give Bill the last word.
Well, I'll be uncharacteristically short. the only thing I would add, and I don't know if this comes exclusively from Phil, but is the idea of stakes lowering, is that I think one of the legal process and pragmatic concerns is that political and policy disagreements should not be escalated through the law. And this often occurs in criminalization. This is what I fought my whole life against in the criminalization of gay people. Gay people were considered psychopaths and criminals. And that was absurd from a conservative, traditionalist, religious point of view, okay? And I think we see that, I think that is a national neurosis. The tendency of Americans of all stripes to criminalize policy disagreements or even ethicalize it, you know, to take it down from the criminal front, to turn policy disagreements into moral disagreements. And we've seen this in the abortion debate, et cetera. So I think maybe this is more the Midwest than it is just Phil Fricke. It seems to me that that's a good, and the president is a Midwesterner. So I think that this would be something that I would urge on our, let's see. Is he our first Midwestern president since Ford? Is that right? I don't know. Another Fricke state, you know, Michigan, et cetera. So bring it always back to Phil Fricke. Since our last and perhaps only Michigander president, I think our first Illinois president since Lincoln would be well advised not to raise stakes on things.
Wonderful. Well, I want to thank this incredibly august panel, and keep in mind, this is just the beginning of the conversation. I think it's fair to say we're off to a very good start on this symposium. Thank you.
Thanks for the moderator.